I chose him, but now he can answer.
She did. She watched all of my movies, gave notes on all of them, and then said she's willing to do it. So, like most kids of the 80s and 90s, I grew up with Dr. Ruth's voice being ubiquitous throughout the house, knowing that she was the sex educator. But of course, I never thought I would meet her, much less be making a film about her. But 2 years ago, I was invited to have dinner with her in New York.
By Rafi,
our producer, who had a kind of personal relationship or personal connection to Dr. Ruth. We had dinner, that was 2 years ago, on the Upper East Side. And I just fell in love with her story. I didn't know, you know, I knew that she was America's sex therapist. I did not know the 55 years of challenges and traversing the world that she had done before she became Dr. Ruth, which, if you see the film, is really what it focuses on.
What do you mean, if you see the film? You have to see the film. I want to get an Academy Award nomination.
I am not saying yet
an Academy Award. I want to get an Academy nomination for Ryan and for Rafi. I have had offers from television studios, from cable studios. I have had lots of offers from different filmmakers, and especially in the later years. And I always said, no, I'm enough on television. I'm enough in the media. I do have 40 books. I talk enough. I'm not interested. Especially I wasn't interested in talking about my early years and about the tragedy of being an orphan of the Holocaust. And then I saw a film, not only Ryan's film, I saw a film that Rafi did called No Place on Earth. And that sentence stuck with me, because I also have that sentence in a children's book that I just did. A graphic novel,
yeah.
Rollercoaster Grandma, because that was my story, that no place on earth for Jews, for being rescued from the Nazis. So when I saw that sentence, I said, oh, that Rafi, I have to look at him. Then I watched all of his movies. I watched Proposition 8, and I was very impressed. And then I watched his movie about the woman who worked with the Beatles for 40 years and had never been on television. Then I watched his film about the tennis player
Serena Williams.
And then I watched, as I told you, I watched The Keepers, and that really was a cliffhanger. I could not stop going from one episode to the next. So loud and clear, he owes me 7 hours of my life that I spent in front of television. I want to tell you, very important, and I'm going to repeat that the whole day, that I have not regretted my decision to do that with Ryan. He's a brilliant filmmaker, but he also learned a lesson. He learned a lesson that people like me out of Germany, out of bad happenings, people like me don't cry in public. So he tried. I can tell 2 hours of all the tries, he doesn't even know. He tried to make me cry, no luck. No luck whatsoever. So he actually, in the back of his mind, he can have another film with me where maybe I will cry. I doubt it.
It was about a year and a half that we filmed with Dr. Ruth. And like she mentioned, we traveled the world with her. So she still goes a mile a minute. She published 3 books while we were filming. She still teaches 2 university classes. So she's still going a mile a minute. And so we were following her day-to-day life for about a year and a half, and hundreds of hours of footage. And she would allow us to be with her from morning till night. So there was a lot of downtime too, where we would turn the cameras off and just have lunch. But when we were with her, we were with her from morning till night.
Yeah.
Hold it loud and clear. I'm going to ask him, you are the first one to hear that. I need all of the footage that's in the cutting room on the floor.
Okay.
Not today, not tomorrow.
Okay.
When you have time.
We'll figure it out.
But don't throw me in the garbage.
Would never.
And this film, Ask Dr. Ruth, is really a testimonial to the parents that I lost at the age of 10 and a half when they placed me, my mother and grandmother, you did that beautifully with the animation, when they placed me on a train to safety to Switzerland. So for me, this year and a half, I said, Ruth Westheimer, you are now 90 and a half, and you have an obligation. It's like setting a gravestone for my whole family who don't have graves. So that was in the back of my mind. And then I also wanted to show that, look what can happen out of such a tragedy of an orphan. And now I have to say something about today. I'm not involved in any political party. I vote every single election, but I'm very sad today. And I'm going to repeat that all day long today. When I see families being separated, when I see children being separated from their parents, it reminds me and makes me very, very sad of what I had to go through, that I had to say goodbye to a loving family, being an only child, and never see them again. So that's one of the things. The other thing is, in today's world, I do stand up, even so I'm not a political person, I stand up for abortion has to remain legal. I stand up for Planned Parenthood, that family planning has to be available for everybody. And I stand up that we still have to do research and find ways of protecting people from sexually transmitted diseases, not just AIDS, not just the gay community, everybody, even older people these days, they engage in sexual activity because they think it doesn't matter. They think there's medication available, not so.